Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, and good afternoon, everybody. We will talk today. I think this is the first lecture in the series of uveitis block as subspecialty lectures. It will be wise to know the classification, how would you work up those patients, and we will touch upon epidemiology of uveitis at the end of the lecture. As most of you know, usually the subspecialty lecture, in my opinion, need to be more interactive. Interrupt me at any time. I will ask you a couple of questions and will present some slides. And hopefully we'll have, at the end, take-home messages that will make uveitis an easy topic to tackle and easy patient to manage. First, we'll talk about the classification. Classification, if you go and read in the books or the literature, or even in the files, when you write, you will have different classification, either based on the location, the duration of uveitis, character of inflammation, is it granulomatous versus non-granulomatous, the etiology of the uveitis, I mean infectious, non-infectious, inflammatory, related to other immune-related diseases in the body. So all of these classification help and will be good to know which category you are dealing with. Lakin, because of the diversity of this classification, we need to standardize it. For that, there was a group of uveitis specialists met, I think, in 2000, 2005, and they come up with the standard classification in uveitis when we are talking about onset, the acute versus chronic, what are the definition, what will be the plus one. This is important when you are consulting or you are dealing with your colleague to tell him, and you need to speak the same language. It is important to look to this classification and to make it sort of standardized for all of us to speak the same language. So when we are saying anterior uveitis, it is meant to be the iritis, iridocyclitis, and anterior cyclitis. The intermediate, on the other hand, will be focused on the intermediate part of the in the eye. So we are talking about the pars plana. So they have pars planitis, posterior cyclitis, and hyalitis, which is only the inflammation in the vitreous, or the posterior hyaloid. The posterior uveitis is retina or choroid, and it will be multifocal or focal, and it will be retinochoroiditis or retinitis, and also neuroretinitis. If you have all these involved, all the layers are involved in the inflammation, you will label this as pan-uveitis. And this narcomixture is the standardization of uveitis done in 2005, and we'll give you the reference when we end up at the end of the lecture. When you talk about the onset or the duration or of the uveitis, you need to know, is it sudden or insidious? And then you need to know the duration. If it is limited, we're talking about less than 3 months. And if it is persistent, will be more than 3 months. And you need to know, is it acute or recurrent or chronic? And in acute, it is episode of characterized by sudden onset and limited duration. Whereas recurrent is repeated episodes of separated by period of inactivity without treatment for more than 3 months. In chronic, it is persistent uveitis with relapse in less than 3 months after this continuation of the treatment. You need to label it. What case you are dealing with? Is it acute or chronic or recurrent? And we'll have some example. In the clinical exam, you need to look to the visual acuity, color vision to rule out any other associated or optic nerve involvement, intraocular pressure, afferent pupillary defect, conjunctiva and the sclera, the cornea. It is just a part of your regular clinical exam. But you need to focus on these findings, which is usually the keratic precipitate, presence of nodules, the AC reaction, what is the extent of the AC reaction, and if there is nodules, where is it located, and is it inflammatory or something else, and you need to comment on also in the lens. These are the anterior part of the exam. Also, not to forget the fundus exam, which is an important thing to look at and to do when you are dealing with uveitis. If you are sending patient without dilated fundus exam, that will be inappropriate, and even it will be medically legally wrong, because you cannot label what type of uveitis, and you cannot rule out any posterior pole involvement or even intermediate sort of uveitis, which is not uncommon to have anterior part of AC reaction, and then it is associated with snowballs or snow banking, and that will shift the patient from anterior uveitis to intermediate uveitis. This is an example. Also, dilating the patient will serve both mission. One, to know the diagnosis. The second thing is to prevent the synechia. So dilating patient, especially uveitic patient, is mandatory. Okay? Usually it will not be enough to just say, I just look with the 90 to the optic nerve and the macula and it is normal. You need to do dilated fundus exam and even with depression. Okay? Sometimes it is good to comment about the iris nodules, and we know based on the location you will label them. So the copy is usually associated with the granulomatous uveitis, and it is in the pupil margin, whereas the bosaca is in the mid iris. And we have less frequent, which is the Berlin's KPs, which is usually presented in the angle. All of these usually associated with granulomatous uveitis, although sometimes COBE is associated with Fuchs, which is classically classified as non-granulomatous uveitis. And we will talk about this in a minute when you are dealing with certain classification. It doesn't mean that you have a black or white sort of landmark. It's just a collection of history and exam and findings to guide you to the diagnosis. And before that, it will guide you to the steps of the investigations. And then you will hopefully reach to the final diagnosis. But it doesn't mean that you have these KPs that's equal to TB, or that molten fat KPs or nodules that will be equal to sarcoidosis. It doesn't work like this, because there is usually an overlap, and there are some entities that present with granulomatous, and sometimes it will be granulomatous, and also vice versa. Like it is important thing to keep in mind, but it will not guide you exactly to the diagnosis itself, but with other findings that will be helpful for you to reach the diagnosis. Okay, let's take an example now. Who's Omar? First year, Omar.
So, 37 years old male, patient with left eye pain with redness for 2 weeks. He had similar complaint before 6 months ago, in the same eye. He's living outside Riyadh, no history of trauma. There is, this is his clinical photo without dilating drops.
So, okay.
Okay.
Tell me in this scenario, what are the important thing in the stem of the question are important and okay. For you?
He's 37, so not old.
Middle age. Okay.
Male. History of pain and redness, which is recurrent.
And it and is, acute. And the complaint is one eye, huh? It is mostly
eye.
You are dealing with unilateral. Yes. That is important, okay?
No trauma, and living outside.
Why I said this, what is why it is important? Do I just put it like this?
I think there is two important things, that he might not be able to reach the hospital in very, not close by, so the medical care will not be as good maybe. And also he could be living in rural areas, which is like more fungal or other related problems.
Okay, so the social background of the patient is important, not only in this patient. Just want to put an alarming thing that we sometimes neglect, especially in ER, that usually you are dealing with the patient, they don't ask him where is he from and where is he coming from. And that, in my opinion, especially in those patients with chronic or something repeated, that you don't want to bring them all the time to the ER. You ask him to come tomorrow to see me, and then after 2 days to do CT scan, and then. So try to help those patients. As you know, sometimes the patient need is different than somebody who's living in the same city. Huh? Plus the medical reason that you mentioned. Okay. طيب, go ahead and describe what you are seeing.
Okay. This is an external photo showing engorged vessel.
Okay, what do you call this in?
Ciliary injection.
Okay, ciliary injection. Usually, ciliary injection is secondary to one sign of inflammation inside the eye.
Yes.
Okay, so this is important. It's different than injection all over, mm-hmm. which will be indicating something else. Okay, what else?
I see at least one KP in the right eye, right picture.
Okay, this yes. one. Okay.
Cannot assess the AC.
Okay, very difficult to do so. How about this one?
Maybe old scars.
Yeah, okay, so there is a faint cornea scar. Yes, collectively you are, what else? Is this pupil normal?
Kind of mid-dilated.
Okay, it's a bit dilated, and?
Is there KPs, maybe? Copies?
No, there is no nodules, but the pupil is a bit shifted to this area. It's not rounded all over. It's a bit shifted here. And what is here?
Pseudic
sphere. Abdurrahman, maybe you are from front, you know. What is there? Huh? Iris atrophy, yeah. There is translumination. Maybe it's not so clear, like, at least Abdurrahman, he picked up transillumination of the iris. So now, from these pictures, just conclude me the important things. You are dealing with unilateral?
Unilateral inflammation. Could be anterior, could be intermediate uveitis. Most likely granulomatous uveitis.
Okay, so you have large KPs that may point you to granulomatous, and we have an iris atrophy and corneal scar and unilateral. Anything that you want to ask about or you want to test?
Cornea sensation.
Okay, so cornea sensation reduced.
Okay. Any vascularization? I cannot see any corneal vascularization.
Okay, you want to...
Dilate the eye, of course. Do you see...
IOP, pressure is important.
Yes, high IOP.
IOP, okay. And he's having element of cataract, okay. طيب. So what will be your working diagnosis? From these signs only, what will be your impression?
Could be herpetic
based uveitis. Based on the classification that we mentioned, with this information that you are having.
Could be herpetic uveitis.
And we want to have the working impression first. What you are dealing with? This is bilateral... Unilateral?
Unilateral.
Okay.
Unilateral could be anterior uveitis.
Posteriorly, he is normal, so that will be good to know. There is no posterior activity, no retinitis, no optic nerve involvement. So now we had unilateral, anterior uveitis.
Yes.
What else?
Unilateral acute anterior uveitis.
Acute, okay, that's good, 2 weeks. Yeah.
Recurrent.
Recurrent, based on the history at least. Okay. And it's not
KP,
only the history, so also the iris. Usually the iris atrophy will not present any in the first attack. Usually take time. Okay. So this is unilateral, acute, recurrent, granulomatous anterior uveitis, and then you say rule out HSV keratouveitis. This is the classic diagnosis. And in every, why I brought this as an example, in every word that indicates something. Whenever you consult somebody and tell him this information, that means you are sure you did all this and you rule out the other things. Okay. And then you can talk about the management and all this stuff. Anything in the history that you want to ask about?
He said no previous trauma.
Mm-hmm.
But any inflammation of the eye in general, inflammation of the eye before.
What other good differential diagnosis in this patient? Let's say he's having AC reaction, plus two. One thing that's usually related to HSV. We will talk about it just a minute. That's okay. Okay, so now in the grading of anterior uveitis, usually we are looking mainly to the cells. And again, this is the requirement to have the size and the high illumination. And then you will label the patient according to this, plus 1, 6 to 15, plus 2, such and such, and plus 4 is more than. And in the sun classification, they just label hypopian to be added. You say plus 3 with hypopian or whatever. Previously, it was plus 4 is hypopian, but now you need to mention that the hypopian is present. And in the flare, also there is definition of flare to make it standard. Plus 1 if it is faint, plus 2 it is moderate, iris and lens detailed are clear, plus 3 when the iris and lens details are hazy, and plus 4 when there is fibrine or blastic aqueous. Okay. طيب, let's say that you have this patient and you had full history of the patient and you had the clinical exam and you lean to one of the diagnoses. You will do, of course, the vitreous exam and the fundus exam. And there are some tests that may help you to reach the diagnosis. OCT, FFA, and ICG, and ultrasound are of help when you are in need to do them, but not to reach exactly to the diagnosis, like in back to give you supportive findings that will help you in the diagnosis. Again, the vitreous haze, you have zero if it is nil, minimal if it is plus one with cerebral polyx clearly visible, and you will be going to 4 or 5 when you have severe fundal detail are not visible. And usually this is associated with severe vitritis, especially what are the cause of bad vitritis usually? Acute retinitis, so acute retinal necrosis is one example. What other? Toxoplasmosis is another bad vitritis cause. Okay. So in the working diagnosis, we need to know, is it unilateral or bilateral? And then you have a list of differential diagnoses. We need to know, is it acute or chronic, or acute versus chronic? And then also you need to know, is it granulomatous or non-granulomatous? And at the end, we need to know, is it anterior, intermediate, or posterior, or pan-uveitis? What is the commonest cause of granulomatous uveitis in Saudi Arabia? We will say this in the epidemiology study. If you have the feeling that either one of them, but you need to test it. And how would you know? You will go back and look for your patient, and then you would know which is which. So we will talk about this. But it's not sarcoidosis. Huh? Okay. This is take us to the point that where you are practicing, that will influence your diagnosis. If you are practicing here, TB and VKH will be more than sarcoidosis. If you are practicing in the Western country, sarcoidosis will be much more than these entities. Okay. What are the investigations? This is usually a point of a discussion, which investigation you will order. And there is no sort of a kit of test to all the uveitis cases. It depends on your findings, which is usually depend on the history and the clinical exam. And then the investigation will be helpful. It's not the one will reach to the diagnosis by the investigation. It's just something to help you and to rule out other entities that may mix the picture for you. So CBC and ESR, urine and electrolyte, PPD, especially in our country, chest X-ray versus CT scan. which is when you will do CT scan and when you will do X-ray. Let's say the patient that you have a while ago, the one Amr was commenting on, you will do what? You will do it or I will not do it? How many of you are saying I will do it? How many of you, I will not do it? Why should you do an X-ray for a patient with herpetic, most likely, HSV, keratu, uveitis? What you are afraid to move from? TB, why should it be mixed? Will you use steroid in herpetic anterior uveitis? Then you should do for all patients with PRK, LASIK, that you are using topical for them 2 months, you need to do X-ray to rule out TB. So it is not. Back to the thing that يعني, there is ما في يعني وصفة أنه والله خلاص those I need to do it on all uveitis patient. It's not. It's based on the clinical exam and the history. And then you will do the clinical, the test that you need. Sometimes you need to do X-ray and sometimes you don't need even to do X-ray and sometimes you don't need to do X-ray, you will do CT scan rather than X-ray. Based on what you are suspecting. But somebody who has anterior uveitis of HSV, which is most likely with the reduction of corneal sensation, iris atrophy, all this, you don't need to do all these investigations. You may do UNE, CBC, it's okay, because you are going to give him acyclovir, which may affect his kidneys. I will take that. But X-ray, it's not. And it is an example to tell you that sometimes you don't need all these investigations. And sometimes you need all of them. And at the end, you will not end up having diagnosis. And it is something to help you. The CT scan and X-ray, usually if you are suspicious of granulomatous uveitis, I will do CT scan. If it is only non-granulomatous uveitis, and I just want to rule it out, it's not something that I suspect, it's not in top of my differential diagnosis, I do X-ray for both. Just to rule it out, and also for clearance of oral steroid, although some of the internists are saying you don't need to do it. But still, I have some sort of reservation for that, so I will do X-ray if I want to start oral steroid, or if I want to do anti-TNF or immunosuppression. Like, if I'm having granulomatous uveitis with molten fat KBs, and this patient is from Saudi Arabia, middle age, and they have no other causes, or the TB is in the first or second or third diagnosis, I will go immediately to CT scan. I will not go to the X-ray. And even if the X-ray came normal, I still have suspicious. I'll not be sure that he has no lung involvement. Okay. And then you reach to the final diagnosis after the history and the exam. Hopefully you reach the diagnosis, and in the diagnosis you need to know, is it a local disease in the eye or a systemic disease that need a teamwork and also need treatment? And also important to know, is it infectious or inflammatory? And you need to rule out infectious, as we said, TB. And there are reported cases of death after the ophthalmologist gave immunosuppression for a patient who has not worked out and tend to be an infectious and end up with miliary TB, for instance. Okay. And based on the classification, say severe and mild, and in this I would put in between brackets, is it sight-threatening? Well, sometimes, like in Behçet disease, you have inflammation or retinitis around the macula or around the optic nerve. In that case, it will not be like a Behçet patient who is having only anterior uveitis. The treatment will be different. In that case, the one who is having retinitis or bad retinitis, I may go immediately to start him on anti-TNF, on infliximab. Okay? And the other one, I may not. I'm just doing him topical and maybe the steroid to start with, or immunosuppression like Imuran will be enough, which is the classic treatment of Behçet disease. Like, and if you have somebody who is having a visual threatening disease, your treatment and intervention will be more sort of aggressive, and even sometimes we need to admit those patients. And we're dealing with blinding disease, okay? And that will come from you guys when you are in the ER. You would guide the management and you guide the treatment when you tell us exactly what you are dealing with. You are dealing with severe panuveitis, that most likely it is granulomatous in that patient. You usually need to admit them. And on the other hand, somebody who is having a first attack of anterior uveitis, I just will tell you, if the other things are ruled out, this is no need for investigation, and the patient is having good chance that it will be the first and last attack of uveitis. And in between these two extremities, you will have distribution of cases. Some cases need immediate action, sometimes the patient needs admission, sometimes need to have internal medicine to evaluate the patient with you and board, and need to be a rheumatologist also with you to initiate the immediate treatment. And sometimes you just be capable to do the treatment yourself. One important issue also when you reach the diagnosis and say that you give the patient the right treatment, the follow-up. In the follow-up visit, you need to, also the early visit, you need to look for, of course, for the symptom and VA and IOP inflammation investigation and the medication effect and side effect. These are the early visits. And in the subsequent visit, you need to include all these and to think about your immunosuppression treatment. Because sometimes the immunosuppression is the cause of the trouble, complication of the treatment, initiating or reducing the dose. All these are questions that you need to keep in mind when you are following those patients. And again, mostly in following those patients, you need to do a complete clinical exam. You need to dilate those patients. All the patients need to be dilated. No matter what was the initial presentation, let's say that you are labeling them as anterior uveitis, and after 3 years, you need to dilate them, because there are some cases that will be progressed or shifted to another form of uveitis. They will be intermediate, or they will be panuveitis if you don't look to them again. And sometimes we revise our diagnosis. There was one patient that we were following as a case of idiopathic uveitis and turned to be multiple sclerosis after 3 years. When she developed numbness, and then sent her to do MRI, and there was an lesions in the brain, confirmed the diagnosis of MS. She was having intermediate uveitis. Revising the diagnosis every now and then is important in your test. And also, as I told you, the side effect of the medication that you are giving. Let's say a patient in methotrexate. How would you follow them from the medical point of view? Okay, a lefty, CBC and the lefty, because? Okay, so they affect the bone marrow and they may affect the liver. So this is one example of that patient that they need to have. A patient also in CILCEPT, they need also to have a periodic check. In the first treatment, they will need it to be done every month, and then subsequent visit need to be 3 to 6 months as blood work. If you are dealing with those patients with a colleague from the medical, you just make sure that he is following them on time and doing these investigations. Okay. And then you need to know during the follow-up what is the status of the patient. Is he inactive? It will have grade 0 cells, or worsening activity, 2-step increment in the level of inflammation, and example of that, or improving activity, 2-step decrease in the level of inflammation, or complete remission when you have inactive disease for more than 3 months after discontinuation of the treatment. So that need to be clear for you when you write in the file or when you are reporting something, to know the exact terminology and what do we mean by this when we are writing it. This is the paper that I was telling you about, which is the Sun classification. It came from 2005, and it's now become the standard for classification of uveitis, and we're talking about the inflammation, the grade of inflammation. Okay, any questions so far? No, Abdurrahman, you have a question? You're putting your pen as if you want. Yes. Excellent question. So the question is, when you have a KPs, how would you know this is an active or indicating activity or no? But the color of the KPs, yes, it indicates. When you have it more of a creamy-like color, usually indicating activity. And in the term of resolving, it will become pigmented or it will resolve completely. You have patients that they will be pigmented first in a couple of months, and if you control the disease for years, it will be resolving. You will just see a faint mark on them. The KPs color is important to know is it active or inactive. And that will be one of the questions that when you consult me in the ER or consult the uveitis specialist, they will ask you, you say, okay, I'm having KPs. What are the characteristics of these KPs? You need to know the size, the color, and the distribution. So we talk about the color. What about the size? Abdurrahman? Yeah, if it is, previously we were saying the moderate or large KBs will indicate more of granulomatous uveitis. How about the satellite lesions? What does it indicate? KBs. What with the folks? Okay, or viral entities. Okay. And the distribution, if it is only inferior or widely distributed, does it make a difference? Hanan? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, the distributed KB is usually indicating either, which is commonly associated with Fuchs, or herpetic. Herpetic uveitis may present with widely distributed KPs, okay? Whereas the most of other entities, HLA-B27 related, VKH, sarcoidosis, which will be the lower part of the cornea. Okay, now the other part that we'll talk about in this lecture is the epidemiology of uveitis. And I'd like to thank Dr. Hassan, he helped me in this and giving me some of these slides. Because there was a major study done in this institute talking about the epidemiology of uveitis and referring those patients to KKH or congenital, which is good studies to be done and will give us like a landmark to know what are the our impression about it. Because if you ask us before these studies, we'd know that TB is more than other entities. But do we have it in numbers? Do we have it as evidence? And this is the importance of these papers. But the research is important to prove or disprove some thought that you are having. And this is what we are having now. So epidemiology of uveitis, males are, and females mostly are equally affected, although there was debate about this and whether female is more like the other immune-related diseases. Like if you take all uveitis entities, including infectious and non-infectious, male and female are mostly equal. The usually it is a middle age in some entities, although some entities like TB is common or herpetic, usually sometimes common and the immunity is reduced. Okay, so it will be more obvious in the late ages. Anterior uveitis is most common, and among these, the idiopathic anterior uveitis is the most common. The incidence in general is 14 to 52, and the 100,000, and prevalence is almost 20 in 100,000. This is one of the studies done also at the university. I think it was 2014. And in that study, the most common anatomical diagnosis was panuveitis, and VKH was the number one in their. I think I have a table of this. Yes, VKH was the commonest cause of uveitis in that series. Any explanation for this, Muhammad Al-Amr? Is this the common scenario that you are having? If you are practicing in, let's say, in Al-Qasim, do you think the same distribution will be like this? Why? Is it open, the microphone, or green?
I don't think so, because it's a referral center.
Okay, so yeah, this is an example. When you are criticizing or looking to a paper, you need to know the setting of that paper. You can apply it in certain aspect, but you will not take it for granted. You will say, okay, this is Saudi Arabia patient, and this is the communist. You need to know the referring system of that study of that paper, and you know to know the sample of those of that study. But that is a little bit shifted or biased sample because this is a referral hospitals. It will not be reflecting the real incidence or prevalence in the community. Okay, but they still have it is valuable papers to know. And you know these are the most difficult cases to treat, and usually these are presented to you, and then these are usually presented to the tertiary care that may need further intervention. Okay, but VKH was common, but the other also good observation in these studies, if you are looking for other studies from, let's say, from the state or North America, you will find HLA B27 maybe number two or sometimes number one. And here we don't see it as much. Again, you need to go back that there is a geographic, ethnic causes or factors that influence the incidence and prevalence, especially it is so obvious in uveitis. But it is the question where you practice, and then you will see what type of patient. Okay. The other study, which was done by Dr. Hassan Dibi and other colleagues from Kekesh, they found also the same, and in their case, also the, I think, was VKH, here is 22%, again, as the idiopathic was commoner, the most common cause of anterior uveitis was idiopathic, which is usually the case in anterior uveitis. There was another also study done in 2002, and that was done, I think, in private hospital by Dr. Khalid Tabara and colleagues, and they found that acute anterior uveitis of undetermined, which is the idiopathic, is the most common, followed by Behçet disease, herpetic, the most common infectious cause of uveitis, and ocular tuberculosis and toxoplasmosis was the most common cause of infectious uveitis at that referring center. It is important to know what was the sample of those patients, but this also will give us a hint that still VKH, Behçet, and TB among the most common causes of uveitis in our community. Okay, let's start now, keeping that mind, and let's apply some of what we mentioned a while ago. And Faisal, I will have maybe 10 minutes to discuss some of the cases.
A 21-year-old male patient presented to general ER with headache and poor visual acuity, right eye for 1 week. He was he had weight loss and no travel history. So the more important history, that is a young male, and it is an acute associated with headache and weight loss.
Okay. Do you want to ask other questions in the history?
Well, his complaint, any non-systemic diseases?
Not known for him, no. Mm. This is the first presentation.
Anterior segment regarding redness and photophobia.
He has no clear photophobia. Mm-hmm. It's so just reduction of vision.
Reduction of vision.
And no redness.
Family history?
No family history.
Contact with similar?
No, he denied any contact. Mm-hmm. And
okay, shall we proceed with the examination? Intraocular pressure and visual acuity.
By the way, apart from the systemic, he's just having the headache. Otherwise, everything is normal. Joint, normal. Mm-hmm. Skin is normal. He has a little bit of loss of appetite, but otherwise, no GI upset is fine from that aspect. The only bothering him is, in fact, he presented to the general ER. It's not ophthalmology ER. Mm-hmm. was having this headache. But they found that he's having also poor visual acuity in that eye. So they ask the ophthalmologist to come and evaluate. Okay?
Okay. No previous attacks?
No previous. This is the first time to he was completely healthy.
Okay.
Otherwise. Okay. So the resident on call came to the ER and examined his fundus and found this.
Mm-hmm. So these are photos of both eyes. Colored fundus photo. In the right eye, I can see the disc is well demarcated. There is a lesion in the macula, superior to the fovea, around one disc diameter, whitish, subretinal, because I see blood vessels over it. And there's some detachment, exudative detachment around it. No other signs of retinitis or vitritis.
Okay. In
the other eye, there's a similar lesion, but very smaller and inferior to the fovea.
Okay. That's good observations. Other thing? Maybe there's something here.
Yes. Yeah. Again, in the right eye, there's a smaller lesion, similar to the one on the left.
So what else now you want to do? Let's say his visual acuity in the right eye is 20/200.
OCT maybe and FFA.
Okay, OCT. We'll show you that he is detached. What is more important then?
FFA.
Okay, FFA. Let's do this FFA. There's multiple shots, but I get this just to have the feeling.
The first photo in the upper looks in the laminar phase. The right eye. The lesion which we saw in the color photo is hypo. Fluorescent and becoming more hyper in a later image.
Okay.
With diffuse leakage in the area of the exudative detachment.
Okay. So, what you are dealing with? From the fundus, what is this?
Inflammatory this process with leakage.
Yeah. Okay.
There is no scars that what I remember around it in the color photo, but there is only leakage in this fundus
photo. So I want you to pick up something, what you will label this as. You said subretinal or something, and what could it be? Would it fit a...
Chorioretinitis?
Aywa? Yeah, choroid granuloma. Mostly this is choroid granuloma. The idea of bringing this is not to discuss the FFA and the finding. The idea to order certain tests for a certain patient. So that patient, we didn't go to other, you will not do B scan for this instance for the time being. You will not do OCT, will not be that much. But here FFA is helpful for you to reach the diagnosis. Okay, let's go back to our patient. He's having this finding, and he's from Saudi. What are the things that in your mind?
TB, to rule out TB.
Okay.
Other granulomatous.
So what is the cause of headache if he is having TB? And how would you link all these? Any thought? Sad. No. Maybe, but it is not. Usually the classic VKH will be not this. Sarcoidosis is another thing to think about. Masquerade. Okay. Type TB is not. Yeah, but I'm saying to him, how would he explain TB, the headache with TB? That will be explained by TB, but why headache? Patient is bothered by headache. Yeah, so what do you call this? Meningitis, huh? They may have tuberculosis meningitis. Okay. And in fact, he had this. He had brain involvement, and he had this. Talking about this patient, 21 years, with sort of miliarity, because it's involving the eye and involving the, and he has lung changes, and he has brain involvement. What are the things that you want to think about in that case? Other than? Okay, good. So immune status of the patient, you need to check it, okay. So this is a message from that case. And you need to do for him immune workup just to rule out any immune deficiency. And he had immune deficiency at the end. Starting from an ocular symptom or sign, then we come up with life-saving scenario. It's important for you when you evaluate a patient, you need to link every symptom or sign to reach at least to the best diagnosis. Okay. Where on the other hand, there is such a case here, Wafi.
So we have a 26 years old female patient with mild blurring of vision in her left eye. We have unilateral complaint, mm-hmm. and a young female patient.
This is a close picture for the cornea. So what do you see here?
Fine stellate KBs.
The ones who's asking about satellite, usually it will not be rounded. It will be like there is an extension. And this, by the way, will be so obvious when you do for them confocal scan. It will be so clear that for you sometimes that there is a satellite or connection to these KBs. So this is wide distributed KBs, most likely diagnosis?
I will put FOX, heterochromic iridocyclitis, in my top of the differential.
Other one?
Herpetic uveitis.
HSV, okay. That's good. Why I brought this after that one? This one is a pure eye involvement. And in fact, in uveitis, usually you don't need to give them the treatment. Just manage the complication, which is cataract and glaucoma. Whereas in the other patient, you are talking about the life. In all, they are labeled as uveitis, but this one is different than that uveitis. So you need to know when you're dealing with it, you need to have complete picture of the disease to know how to manage. They need to run this quickly. Need to have one quick. Who want to take this? Mafi, volunteer, I have to pick. It was sad. Just give quick. Yeah, maybe these are KBs.
KBs and Busaka and nodules.
Yeah, so these are nodules and there is KBs.
And I didn't.
And here.
And there is posterior synechia superiorly. Okay. With a copy nodule on the border. Pupil margin.
And these are different pictures of another patient with large KBs. And here. What is this?
This erythema nodosum.
So, what are the diagnoses most likely?
Sarcoidosis.
Or?
Bahjet.
Bahjet usually is?
Non-gynamitis. Yes.
Okay. TB. So, most this is T. Yeah.
Sarcoidosis.
Sarcoidosis
TB.
Or TB. Yep. This need to be ruled out. Okay. In that patient, I think that this was. Sarcoidosis and this one was TB, I guess. Those are the collection of patients, but these are different patients. Okay. Another one, Hamid.
External photo shows hypopian with conj injection.
Okay. Good.
The fundus photo shows. Perivascular sheathing with inflammatory, what looks like a BRBO picture, because there is intraretinal hemorrhages also.
Yeah, so what you will call this?
Occlusive vasculitis.
Okay. And then this is the FFA.
FFA shows vascular staining and blockage effect by the blood.
Okay, dropout, there's ischemia. Okay, most likely diagnosis?
Paget disease.
Okay, treatment of Paget?
Admission, IV steroids, followed by oral steroids with immunosuppressive treatment, like azathioprine and cyclosporine. If it's severe, we can start infliximab as a primary treatment also.
Okay, good. Okay, thank you. By this, we end up the subspecialty. You have any questions? Aywa, Al-Kareem? That sometimes will be a good justification to go and take this cataract out. But it will not be something urgent. But patient need to know, you need to discuss with the patient that the doing the surgery sometimes will end up with complication. But at the end, you need to weigh things. Match it, if you want. You need my connection or my connection? Yeah, you need to weigh things at the end. But if yesterday, Muhammad with me, were seeing one patient, the cataract was not so significant in terms of even affecting the vision. It was only 20/60 vision. But the retina colleague, or the uveitis colleague, was asking to do it to have clear visualization for the fundus exam. This is why we schedule the patient for cataract surgery. Question, Muhammad? Yeah. Usually you need to observe it. If it is significantly ischemic, sometimes you need to do. For me, usually you will follow it. When you have only localized area of ischemia, there is good chance they will not have vascularization or ischemia. But if you have it, then a significant amount, you may need to do scatter laser for this. What's that? Yeah. It is rare. It is rare to present with vitritis. Vitritis usually is not a sign of VKH. Usually they have retinitis and exudative retinitis. Vitritis is not a common feature with VKH. So if you have it, you need to question your diagnosis. Okay. Now, in my opinion, usually if it is small, just small KBs, these still non-granulomatous uveitis. If it is moderate or larger, that will go for more granulomatous sort of inflammation. But as we said back in the slides that we mentioned, even if you know this is granulomatous or non-granulomatous, that will make, it may add to your diagnosis 10%. But you need to have other things to make it 100% sure about the diagnosis. Okay. Thank you all.